So it's tempting to think that we understand protein folding now, but not so fast. First, this will only work for quite small proteins, but there are some proteins that are large. The other problem is that, as we talked about, many proteins are quite hydrophobic. And if the proteins are very hydrophobic, what can happen is that they collapse so fast that the hydrophobic parts stick together and then they can't really fold. Nature has actually found ways to solve this by using proteins, as always. And this is a chaperonin, GRO-EL and GRO-ES. The idea here is that if you're a small protein and you've gotten stuck because you've been a hydrophobic collapse, we can take this entire protein, it can diffuse into this complex. There is a large hydrophobic cavity inside here. This complex will actually use ATP, just as some of the pumps we spoke about in the membrane proteins. It will use the ATP to open up, change its conformation, then it will close this cap, and then we have a hydrophobic environment in here. And now my small protein will happily unfold a bit and hopefully have time to slowly fold into the right conformation, and then it's going to be released by the chaperonin again. Why do I show you this? Well, partly to show that life is more complicated in practice. But the other part is that we haven't solved this part with how fast proteins fold. Remember Cyrus Leventhal? We still have that problem, right? I've just said that one way or another, there should be a free energy path here, things should be able to fold, but I haven't solved the fact that this needs to happen in finite time, and there is no way the protein can test all those conformations. Go back and check the lectures on Leventhal's paradox if you don't remember that. So one way or another, we need to understand why proteins can form fast. And the second I say fast, that means looking at the kinetics and how fast things happen, literally. There could be a few smart ways. Remember the ribosome that we're having the RNA chain, small subunit, large subunit, and then the actual protein comes out here. Maybe, just maybe, we could have the, if the N-terminal comes out here first, it would be really smart if proteins started to fold from the N-terminal, because then it's always a matter of the next structure, or the next amino acid. That's going to be local. We won't have to test every single possible combination. It's a beautiful model. The only problem is that it's wrong. It doesn't work that way. Because remember that we could take a protein, we could put it in water, we could denaturate it, and then it would spontaneously refold. That is not compatible with the N-terminus folding first. So Christian Amfinsen kind of proved this model wrong. There are of course proteins where this happens, but in general it's not true. So we're still stuck that we haven't solved Leventhal's paradox. And the only way we can understand kinetics is that we're going to need to start looking into a possible few possible candidate models, how things might fold, and then examine if they could explain why it is so fast. And that's going to need to take us to a small odyssey of a few different models. Join me.